Well, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. We gather here today to pay our last respects to Frank Elliott Stevens, a husband, a father, a grandfather, an uncle, a brother, and a friend. And on behalf of Dickie and her family, I greet you and thank you for attending this memorial service and for supporting those who grieve today due to the passing away of a dear soul. Although we grieve, let us also think of the precious times granted to us that we have shared together over the years, and celebrate a life which was well lived and filled with integrity and feeling for those around him, and which makes a person so special. Let us pray. We have come today to remember the precious life of Frank Elliott Stevens, to say goodbye one last time, and to celebrate the life that he enjoyed here on earth. And thank you, O God, for each moment and memory that we have had with him. His life touched so many people in various ways, and as we think on these things, we seek your presence and peace to be upon us during this tumultuous time. Almighty God, in the quietness of the day, we have gathered for these last solemn and tender offices of faith and love, as we remember with thanksgiving for the life of Frank, that you will lift us up above the shadow of mortality with the light of your presence, and speak to each one of us a word of peace as we face the mystery of death. Look down in tender mercy on this family whose joy has turned into mourning, and uphold them that they will find strength and refuge in you, O God. We bring each one into your presence and pray that even now and the future ahead you will nurture them in your arms, and through sorrow and loneliness be their comforter and strength. Bring a new joy and peace that passes all understanding into each life here today. And let your abundant love and grace that will always be sufficient to uphold them in the days that lie ahead. Amen. We're going to sing a wonderful rendering, and I sat with the family and I said, you know, with Frank, all things were bright and beautiful. And we're going to remember that today as we sing All Things Bright and Beautiful. Have we got the music?
Things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small. Things wise and wonderful, Lord God made them all. Each little flower that opens, each sweet bird that sings, He made.
Expressing our love and our thoughts we have for our beloved Frank. As we travel down memory lane, memories are precious and live forever within us. So let's share them together on this occasion. We will call on each one who would like to come and pay a tribute. If you can come in succession, who have requested to express their love for Frank and their memories for him.
Hello, my name is Gail, and I am talking and sharing our thoughts of Dad on behalf of his three daughters, Lynn, Cobb, and myself. To all our family and friends, thank you for coming and sharing this time with us as we celebrate our dad's life. These past 4 weeks have been the most difficult thing we have ever had to experience in our lives, but at the same time, the most beautiful. A lot of people don't get the opportunity to spend time with their loved ones before it is too late. With us today are Kirsty and Baz, who just unexpectedly lost their dad, and I'm not sure if Kathy and Jane are here, but we would like, as behalf of our family, to express our sincere condolences to you. We were so fortunate that our mom and five children were able to be at Dad's side and go through his journey with him. Our dad has always been the big, strong guy that we looked up to, but we all got to experience another side of him that he had not shown us before. The incredibly strong infection, as well as mild stroke, had taken such a strong hold on Dad that he was not really responsive and able to communicate. We did not know if he would ever come out of this present state, but we just kept on repeating and telling him, "We love you so much, Dad." Now, we always knew Dad loved us and showed his love in many ways, but not always verbalizing how he loved us. You can imagine how we felt when Dad finally woke up after about 2 weeks, and the first thing he said in his hard-to-understand speech was, "Love you more." As Dad's speech gradually returned to being our old pulse, we really started to fully understand the depth of his love. He told us on one visit he was sorry he did not show us more affection, but over the following weeks we came to realize how much he truly did love us. By things he said and did, whenever we would leave him at the hospital, we would say, "Love you, Dad." His answer every time was, "Love you more." We were so pleased that Dad had a great visit with family on the last Thursday, particularly with his sister Marion. He was able to give her a great big bear hug. She told him she loves him, and he said, "Love you more." Dad and his sister were always very close and cared so much about each other. We asked Auntie Marion if she could say something about Dad. Her immediate response was, "He was her protector. When growing up, she never had to worry about anything. When Dad was around, he was always her protector." Dad has been a protector not only of his sister, but many people throughout his life. Dad spoke to us about many things and made our time with him worth more than anything in the entire world. On one occasion, he told us that he thinks he had been too strict with us all. "Well, yes, Dad. You have been very strict with us growing up." One distinct memory of that is how we had to make sure we knew all our multiplication and division tables because you could randomly be quizzed on the way to school from the farm. You had better make sure you knew them. Needless to say, we always did very well with our quizzes at school. Dad would also test us on our spelling, but secretly probably had to look really well at the spelling before those quizzes, as spelling was not one of his strong points. And another thing he was very strict about when we grew up, that as a child, you had to say hello to everyone, goodbye, and thank you. And I think that just goes to us throughout our whole life. There are many things you were strict about, Pops, but you know what? We all turned out okay and are better because of your strictness. We also know how proud you were of your 5 children. Dad's humor never disappeared in the hospital. He would come out with some seriously funny stuff that really made our day. We said to Dad, "You chose the best wife ever," and he told us, "She got the cream of the crop." One day he said, "Where were you? I was worried about you." We said, "Not as worried as we are about you, Dad." He asked us one day, "Is it vital that they take my vitals?" So, yes, Dad, it was. We said to Dad, "We had an awesome 60th anniversary party last March. You got to 60 really easily." And he replied, "Really? For who? Me or Mom?" We said, "Both of you." Mom was lying in the lazy boy chair next to him one day, and we said to Dad, "Mom is a bit low." And he said, "That's okay. We know when we are next to each other." He told us that, "I want to give you all a big hug one day." And he said, "I'm really not ready to go and swing on a golden harp." He also told us he is going in a separate entrance. We told him that was not true. "Dad, you would have loved to win the lottery to be able to help other people. But actually, you did in many ways. Many may not know this about Dad. Although he was very frugal in a lot of ways in his own life, he unselfishly helped and supported people in times of need without ever needing or requiring recognition. You won the lottery in choosing Mom as your lifelong partner and wife. Our Mom is the most loving, caring, unmaterialistic person we could ever dream to have for a Mom. Who always supported you in all of your endless passions without complaint." Sorry, just about Mom. "The whole time we were visiting Dad, you were actually rich beyond measure with all the many, many friends whose lives you touched around the world. The whole time we were visiting Dad in the hospital, it was as hard for all our family back home as it had been for us. Although we sent back daily updates, the emotional rollercoaster we experienced with Dad's ups and downs was felt by everyone. We know our whole family would dearly have loved to be with us to celebrate Dad's life. But since that was not possible, I'm going to read tributes from his beloved family back in the U.S. I'm reading from Mike, who was his son-in-law, my husband. As Frank lay ill this past month, I became a bit depressed at the reports of his condition and the failing health of this robust man I have known. I sat a few evenings with a glass of cheap red wine in his honor. They loved to just joke and say they would drink cheap red wine together. And went through my old photographs and gatherings and events. I can almost recite the stories that came about from the different venues. Frank was a great storyteller. Some of these stories were epics in their length, requiring several bathroom breaks and drink refills. My mother passed away in February, and I've completed the task of going through boxes of photos. I realized that I knew very little about my mom. Family history and storytelling just not a part of our culture. I also realized I know a great deal about my father, his life and his escapades. This makes me very happy, and I'm a better person for it. He offered me tons of advice, whether I wanted it or not. I will always remember the advice on people and relationships was that of tolerance and forgiveness, and knowing at some time you could not undo what was done. Thank you for that, Frank. I'm reading now Tony, who is his son-in-law and Colleen's husband. My first memory of Boss, Wellington, 1985. A few months after Paul and I started going out, and she risked me meeting him and Dickie. I was taken aback by the size of the man and his hands. Note to self, don't mess with this guy or his daughter or he'll flatten you. Chata. The last time I spoke to Boss was 10 days ago when he was critically injured in the hospital. His body was failing him, he was completely withered mentally. We had some discussion about his ailments, but then he wanted to know my news. Typical Boss. Never complaining about his own predicament, no matter how bad it was, and always interested in other people. And so many memories in 34 years in between. All those fun family holidays together, poker nights, riding the Busch Gardens roller coaster 6 times in a row in the rain, playing frisbee on the beach, complaining about the Springbok rugby team, the bloody ref. Hearing about Rhodesia again, and so on. You touched a lot of people, and we will all really miss you, Boss. Before I start with Dad's grandchildren and great-grandchildren's tributes, many people may not know how Boss came to be known as Boss. My daughter Janine was the first grandchild. It had never been discussed, but when she was born, I guess I automatically just assumed Janine would call him Granddad, as we had done with our grandfather. Mom and Dad came down from Rhodesia to meet their new grandchild in South Africa, which was really amazing that they could leave their farm and come down. It was the first time Dad had left the farm. When he saw Janine, he told me that he was too young to be a grandfather. He was 48 at the time. Or to be called Granddad, and that his granddaughter would call him Boss. I thought, well, it's a great name, quite suitable actually. So that is how Dad came to be fondly known and loved as Boss, not only by his grandchildren and great-grandchildren, but a lot of his friends throughout the world. I might just add, Dad continued throughout his life to think that he was young, as he showed us all by his continued drive and passion to achieve and do as much as he could in his life. Although his body was telling him no more, that never stopped him. The drive he had continued right up until the day before he went into hospital. He was so excited that he had managed to get good water on the third borehole attempt. Dad, hope you're surrounded by so much water now and abundant and beautiful farm fields where you don't have to worry about how much water you have. Now I'll start on the grandchildren. Janine, I'll start with my children first. Dear Boss, too many fond memories to put into one paragraph because you were a larger-than-life presence throughout our lives. Somehow, I still have vague memories of getting sweets on the sly from your shop in Wellington as a very young child. As I grew older, I remember our visits to Daleside with fondness, except for the royal cabbage you loved. Granny gave me extra rice to make up for the cabbage, though. You were the first person I saw after I crashed the car I had just paid off. Despite your bigger-than-life size, you were so comforting to me. You weren't upset about the car. You were just so visibly relieved that I wasn't hurt. I got so many of the biggest bear hugs from you that day. I am so glad Bobby and I were able to see your home in Fisher Haven in 2006. The best part of that trip was sitting in the back of your bucky with our luggage that you never stopped apologizing for. I love watching you thrive after retirement, amazed at the amazing curry you prepared. I also secretly chuckled when you were unhappy with the curry's outcome because you were oblivious and always, we were oblivious and always loved it. I remember sitting in your lap growing up, receiving life lessons in the form of stories. You had great stories, and I loved hearing them. The Tennessee family reunion was the ultimate platform for you, and we all listened with eagerness. Your stories were life lessons for me. Never forget family, never forget friends, always stay in touch. As I sit here trying to sort my thoughts like jumbled puzzle pieces, I recall sitting in the waiting room at Rex Hospital with Mom and Gran. The room was stifling, yet I wasn't scared awaiting news on how your heart surgery went. For the record, you really did need that surgery. I wasn't scared though because you were the strongest, most determined yet gentle soul around. I had no fear because you always surpassed my expectations and I knew you'd be on your feet in no time with newly prescribed blood thinners. I remember scolding you all the time for doing unsafe things with your blood thinners, telling you it's not safe to climb on roofs, boogie board or climb over backyard walls via cinder block steps. As always, you proved you could do it all. Your strength will never cease to amaze me. It will always inspire me to be better, to do my best, and to support those around me. All my love, your pets. Boss always called her pets. Rion. I have many memories from throughout my life with Boss, and I feel lucky to have been able to learn, laugh, and grow up with him in my life. For my entire life, there was a running joke with Boss where he could and would crush my hand when we shook hands. He could literally still do this up till last year. And while I know he did do this with others, this represents how I thought of him while I was a kid. Specifically, Boss was invincible, a giant with Herculean strength, ability to fix anything, knew everything about cars, engines, etc. There are so many memories from my childhood with Boss, such as sitting on his lap as a child while he's doing his research on horses to bet on them, playing on his farm equipment, watching him work in that massive garage in Daleside, him loudly calling for Dickie, intently watching him play for poker for hours, telling his stories and many more childhood memories both in South Africa as well as in America. As I grew older, I learned more and more from Boss. He was always willing to share his experience, knowledge and opinions. I think everyone will always remember his hilarious songs, stories, etc., but I will also remember the long conversations we had over the years. One of my trips to Dinosaur's Den, sorry, we called Fisher Haven Dinosaur Den. Boss and I sat in the office and went through his stamp collection. We pulled many of those stamp books, looked at old Rhodesian stamps, he described the rare ones, the valuable ones, the ones that took a long time to find, the approach that he takes to hunt down new stamps to complete his collections, etc. Boss loved to share his passions, and it was amazing to just absorb, listen, and even debate with him. Another example is us spending time in his garden, looking at every plant, talking about his water conservation approach, etc. I will forever cherish those moments, especially the moments that Oliver got to spend with him. I can go on and on with all the memories, but what Boss has done as the patriarch of the family is something that will have long-lasting effects far into the future. We owe it to him to try to live with the values that he tried to instill in us and to continue the family bonds that he created. It is up to us now to honor Boss's legacy and to do what we would want to do as a family. Boss impacted my life in a very positive way, and losing him has been a heartbreaking time. He wanted to celebrate us, He would want us to celebrate his love, and while that is difficult to do while mourning, I, for one, am celebrating him and his life. Love you, boss. Thank you for how awesome you were. Kia. Most of my childhood memories of boss start as we turn onto Nine Creek Lane, where boss lived in Raleigh for years. Mom parks a big white van on the street and would climb the steep driveway leading up to the brick ranch, whose garage seems bigger than the house itself. At Nine Creek Lane, we hunt for Easter eggs in the crabgrass in humility. At Nine Creek Lane, boss reclines on his faded pink Lazy. Here, the yard smells of diesel and the house carries the fragrance of Gran's roasted vegetables. Here, it is always hot. The TV blares Jeopardy while Gran pulls biscuit out of an old margarine container, sneaking some to Mitch and me. In the backyard, Mitch and I play with boss's equivalent of child-safe toys. Scrap pieces of wood, hammer, and nails. This is the place where, through his actions and deeds, boss teaches us all what it means to live a good life. Living a good life means taking time on Sundays to call siblings, children, friends, or colleagues to ask them about their week, to show them that you care. Living a good life means lifting his grandchildren up the pink chair, balling up his fist and threatening them with a bop on the nose until we shake with fits of laughter. It means long days of general rental to earn the genuine respect of co-workers, neighbors, and ordinary people. To live a good life means picking up the phone as it rings, bellowing, "Hello!" then waiting a moment before really beginning the conversation so that Brandon can make her way to the phone in the other room to hear the conversation too. At Mine Creek Lane, I sit on Brandon's tiny deflated poof and listen to the adults talking. I realize that to live a good life means involving yourself directly in the lives of the ones you love, to give advice and support, like boss talking to my mom as she navigates raising four kids, including two little boys whose favorite pastime is fighting. In my memory, boss refuses to sit on the sidelines. He speaks freely and confidently, dispensing his wisdom accumulated after a life well lived. Recently, at our last family reunion, we sat around the fire. We knew that boss would soon begin dispensing more of that wisdom. I placed my phone on the ground, ready to record. We had just reminisced about the Stevens family and how flung across America everyone had succeeded in their own way. By the light of the fire, boss said to everyone, "Mom and myself are very proud and happy that we have such a close-knit family, such a hard-working, good family. That is a credit to America. All we wanted in our life was that our kids to become Springbok rugby players or something. But unfortunately, we had alternatives if they couldn't make it. They had just become good citizens, hard-working people, and honest people." I felt then and now that boss was right about so much, that we were close, that we were close-knit, that a good life means hard-working and being hard-working and honest. But there was one thing that felt left out. All those successes, joys, and life lessons may have something to do with America, like he said, but I know, really, it is a credit to him. Andrea, this is Lynn's children. My favorite memories of boss came from the time I spent with him in March and April 2008. I was lucky enough to be present at the 50th wedding anniversary celebration for Granny and boss, and it was so special to celebrate their marriage that day among many family and friends. I also loved the week that I spent with Granny and boss in Fisher Haven a month later. It was precious time with just the three of us where I met many of the friends, visited anonymous, and just took part in their daily lives. There's no particular moment that stands out. It simply was a quiet week of quality time, separate from the dull roar of Stephen's family reunions, where I just took part in normal days for Granny and boss. That time will remain with me forever. Laura. On my first trip to South Africa when I was 8 years old, you introduced me to one of your addictions, cricket. We set the game up in Uncle Russ's huge yard on the Vaal River. Andrea, Brett, and Uncle Russ joined us. I remember thinking at the time that the wickets were just so silly and strange to have in a real game that professionals played. Another hobby of yours that I only later understood was your brilliance with Sudoku. It was obvious that what chair you sat in after you'd gotten up, because a Sudoku book and pen would be on the side table. I loved sitting on your lap and listening to you explain your strategies. after starting from the back of the book and skipping the first 100 puzzles, of course. Another addiction of yours, and probably the most significant, was porridge. You better eat your porridge to grow big and strong, is what you would always say. Boss, no amount of porridge that I could ever consume could make me as tough as you were. The hardest working muscle in your body was your heart, and you had a gigantic one. Thank you for influencing our Stevens clan to become what it is today. You reminded us of the importance of staying together and loving one another, and your legacy will live on forever. Great. I will always remember the profound presence that Boss took up when he was in the room. His energy always captivated the spirit of whatever he was talking about. When he spoke, he always had an audience. His words would resonate deeply and his message would ring true. Anytime you would be with him, a warmth would come over you and you would appreciate everything he had ever done for you and the family. His hard work and deep love for the family was evident in his calloused hands and stories of hard work. If anyone could show that hard work and perseverance pays off, it was Boss. He never took any shortcuts and was a man of honor and integrity. I called him Grandpa once when I was around 4. He grabbed me by the ankle so quick, and I was upside down hanging eye to eye with him in the old farmhouse, and he very softly said, "My name is Boss." And as he put me down gently, I never once again called him Grandpa. Jessica, this is Cole and Tony's children. Boss was a storyteller. One who doesn't want you to miss any detail of the story. The way he illustrated his experience with such depth is actually a true testament to how strong his mind was. I'll never forget driving the 14-hour route to Gatlinburg for our family reunion with him in the passenger seat, where I listened to countless stories that truly depicted what he was really passionate about. I typically jump between Rhodesian politics, cricket, or my personal favorite, the memoirs of a mechanic. Despite having hardly any previous knowledge on these topics, I'm so happy to have such raw evidence of the joys he found in life. Whether I actually knew the difference between the tools he was deliberating between to fix the engine will never be as important as how much they meant to him. His stories will continue to remind me to speak powerfully and unapologetically about what I'm passionate about. It's impossible to forget his spirit, and we were so lucky to have him. Timothy, Frank Stevens, or Boss, as most knew him, will be remembered as an almost mythical human being. His large, warm hands were proof of an active and determined life. Boss embodied the mantra that hard work breeds success, and success for him was the opportunities and lessons he provided for his 5 children, and in turn his 16 grandchildren. Boss's wisdom seemed to supersede his physical presence, and his influence will be deeply rooted throughout his descendants for generations to come. As one of those 16 grandchildren, my memories of Boss include countless stories from his youth, songs from his time in the army, and yearly calls to wish a happy birthday. Boss never failed to bring a smile and never passed them up on an opportunity to give advice to any of his grandchildren. He loved us all equally, and he never failed to express that love whenever he was around. Family reunions without Boss will never be the same, but the close-knit family bonds that he cultivated between all of us will last forever. He will be deeply missed by many, but my memories with him will always be vivid. Enduring love and lifelong support from Diane, Dickie Stevens, Boss's partner in life, cannot be discounted from Boss's legacy. The 61 years of devotion between them are a shining example of a successful marriage. Nicola. As a child, it is hard to realize the true value of your grandparents. Despite knowing how long they have lived, you don't realize how much wisdom they have or how much they mean to you mean to them. This past summer when I lost my boss, was the first time I realized these things. I had the opportunity to ask him so many questions and learn so much about his life. One of my most fond memories is sitting on the back porch of our house in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, while Boss was telling stories and singing songs. I knew in that moment it would be a special memory. Getting to know an amazing person who had an incredible journey through life has taught me so much, and I'm forever grateful for this summer and throughout my life. Christopher. My favorite memory of Boss was receiving birthday wishes from him and Granny every year. It was better than any gift they could have sent to hear their voices and know they were thinking of you that day. No matter what was happening, when I saw that unfamiliar airy coat falling, I knew the day was going to get better. It reminded me of how fortunate I was to have the relationship with him that I did while being halfway across the world. I'll be thinking of you each birthday, right after getting off the phone with Graham. Alex, this is Russ and Vic's children. What I remember about Boss is how he always used to call me on my birthday. How he used Skype so that he could see us. We would always talk to him while he called that. We loved going to all the family reunions to be together and listen to Boss sing his songs. Matt, when I was little, sorry, Matthew, this is Mitch's and Mitch's son and Laurie. When I was little, I remember looking at Boss's hands. I was amazed at how big they were. But now I realize the only thing bigger than his hands was his heart. Even though he lived far away and I know it wasn't easy for him, he still made the journey back to the US to keep the family close. I'll always cherish the time I spent with him and the experience we had. He taught me things I will never forget. He showed me Victoria Falls, he taught me how to play Sudoku when we were on the train together from Cape Town to Johannesburg and spend time together in his garden. He also tried to teach me how to box, emphasizing the tribe. Boss, I promise to take good care of Graham, and I will make you proud because I love you and Graham very much, and also because I know if I don't, you would give me a bump on the nose. Drew, Russ's son. What I remember most is when I laid on Boss's chest. It is sad that I couldn't do it one more time. I wanted to see Boss in the hospital, but my parents wouldn't let me. I always love you. And miss you. In other words, I couldn't come here. Great-grandchildren. Amy. My favorite memory of Boss is probably when we were in Tennessee for the family reunion. It was quite nice waking up in the morning and going downstairs to see him eating breakfast or drinking coffee. He'd always greet me and say, good morning. And I would always give him a good morning hug. I hope he's getting a lot of hugs wherever he is. Angus. I remember having porridge with Boss and how much he loved making sure I ate all mine so I would be nice and strong for the day. His hands were so big, and when he hugged me, it was like being hugged by a giant. I will always eat all my porridge so he knows I'll be strong for the day. Very blessed and touched last night when I got to see Anton, my stepson, who I consider to be my own son. Anton, who unfortunately can't be with us today, traveled from Johannesburg yesterday to come and see the family. Thank you so much, my son. That meant a great deal to the family and especially me. Anton said if he could sum up Boss in one word, it would be patriarch. Dad, you were the patriarch of the family who has left behind a wonderful legacy, not only by your actions throughout your life, but by writing down your legacy. Dad spent many months in Fisher Haven writing in pencil his entire life story. He filled up 5 large A4 size books. I'm not sure how he managed to remember extremely fine details of his entire life, but he did. Dad, you gave us your legacy through your memoirs, and your family can treasure your words for generations to come. Pops, we won the lottery in life by being blessed to have you for our dad. Dad loved to sing, and we have fond memories of him singing all his favorite songs when we had the long drive to the farm and back. One day in the hospital, we asked him to sing us a song, and he immediately started singing, Oh Happy Day. So I'm going to end off by saying, Dad, we love you more, and here is your song, Oh Happy Day. Lynn, Carl, and I will always treasure your last month we had with you, as well as our brothers. When we end now, I just want to mention, at the end of everything, can everyone please go to the back of the hall, and we have a book there, if you could just write something, a little paragraph of your fondest memories of Dad, and just write it in the book, and at some point in time, just light a candle for it on the side of the table. So we'll listen to Dad's song that he sang to us in the hospital, Oh Happy Day. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name's Rob Simpson, for those who I haven't met, and there's a lot of child that I haven't. I'm Uncle Frank's nephew, and I'll do my best to it'll be tough to follow what Gail had to say, but I'm certainly going to do my best to try and actually just give you some of my memoirs of my time with Uncle Frank. And, you know, I'm... Sorry. Okay. I was pretty fortunate to have come from a pretty big family as well, where my mom is Uncle Frank's sister. And I had the equal fortune of growing up with the twins and Mitch and Cole. Unfortunately, Russia went around at that time, so apologies for that. But one of my sort of major influences of the whole families and the gathering was this larger-than-life, strong Rhodesian farmer who just epitomized this really tough guy, and I have to say that over the last 55 odd years, it had a massive influence on my life, and it was always a treat for me to go to the farm, even though I know that the twins of Mitch and Carl probably thought, well, I mean, we need to get out of the farm, it was a bit tough for us. But Uncle Frank and I just shared, I don't know, some weird stuff. It was the love for the bush, shooting, Rhodesia, rugby, cricket, you know, all these strange enough vehicles, cars, you know, it was just, we had this quite uncanny connection that I'll treasure forever. Sorry. And it's quite weird to think that over the years, you know, I can track almost every single incident from the twins, Mitch and myself picking millies and never getting played on Dixie telling that. You know, I think Gail says, yeah, he was tough, and he was tough, and he was hard on you guys, and he was exceptionally hard on you guys. But, you know, look how you all turned out, and look how your whole family's turned out. It's fabulous. You're unbelievable. And I think that's a tribute to the discipline combined with love that he just enthused on everybody. And whilst us guys at times might have lived in fear of the man, because he was tough, wow. We at the same time had this immense respect. And whilst you wouldn't chance your luck with him, and we knew that, it was still, you knew where you stood, you did wrong, he would tell you, he would discipline you. But I just seemed to want to keep coming back to the farm, and I seemed to enjoy the farm. And I followed Uncle Frank to the Fig Tree Farm. I followed him to Edenvale, Wellington, Daleside, the Parais Farm. And there I saw that Russ was drilled and worked hard. I found Auntie Dixon and Uncle Frank sitting under a tree and forcing poor old Russ to plough the lands. And then to Raleigh even, you know, in the US. And I just have to say that this is this patriarch of a wonderful family that is the glue of the family. And the last month was brutally tough for me and for all of you. But, you know, I look back on the all the years we had, and we had such tremendous times together when, even in the early days, Uncle Eric and Auntie Sue and six kids would drive up from Cape Town, and all of us cousins would all be together, and it was just unbelievable stuff. And now we spread over four continents, you know, and it's an absolute tribute that this side of the family gets together. And I had the privilege of getting to one of your reunions 5 years, 6 years ago, and it's a great testament. And without taking anything away from anybody, it's Uncle Frank and Auntie Dix that's the glue to keeping that lot together. And when I was on my own with Uncle Frank in the hospital, and you know, he said to me that it's such a pity all the kids are everywhere across the world, wherever they might be. And unfortunately, that's where Rhodesians and South Africans have ended up, where it's like over four continents. And he said, wouldn't it be nice if they were together at some stage, you know? How you ever pull that off, I don't know. You guys do an unbelievable job getting your families together, and it's fantastic. And I would just say, the way that Uncle Frank would have seen this, because he said to me, you know, Rob, if you got to the States and your family got to the States and your sisters could get over and Erica and all of them were there, imagine, and her side of the family, imagine what it would be like. And it's just so hard to comprehend that. But he achieved it, and he achieved all of that with all of you. And it really is quite amazing. And, you know, you look back in hindsight, and I suppose last year I should have tried harder to maybe get to the reunion in the States. And it was a bit difficult, but you know, you look back, and these are just things that you take for granted, and maybe we shouldn't. You know, you've got to try and make an effort and say, when we want to get together, we get together. And if we're in any parts of the world with social media and Facebook and WhatsApp and whatever, you can connect with anyone and everyone, and therefore there's no excuse for any of us not to be connected with one another. And I've always felt a very strong connection with the five of you, Uncle Frank and Auntie Dix. And so much so that, you know, when Uncle Frank and Auntie Dix came back to South Africa and settled in Fisher Haven and were next door to my folks, you know, I know that you guys are grateful for Jill and I coming out here and seeing them. But you know, it was never something we had to do. It was something we wanted to do. They were incredibly special. They still are. And I'm gonna miss the man like you don't know. There was so much knowledge, you know, and of course we solved Rhodesia's problems like you have no idea. And a better Wenwe you can't get, and I'm a damn good listener when it comes to Wenwe. So, and you know, the army and Rhodesia and rugby, and we happen to be talking about Rhodesia and playing the All Blacks, and you know, they only played them three times, and Uncle Frank had every single fact of all three games, and he was at one of them. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding me, how would you know all of this? a slot, and he's just had just a wealth of knowledge that you know, he liked to talk about the bush cars, and especially the Rhodesian bush, rugby, cricket, politics, and particularly Africa. And you know, we get this African bug, and I suppose we stick around. And I think you guys did a good move getting over to America and sorting out your lives there, because as cousins, your kids will all grow up, and I'm sure it is 50 countries, but it's a lot closer than the four continents that the rest of us all spread over. But I do think that, you know, Uncle Frank and I, many years back, and Mitch might remember it, the twins might remember it, Mom and Dad were there, and there was at Granddad's funeral, Auntie Dick's, at the Moth Shrine in just outside Bulawayo. And a few years after that, or quite a few years after that, Uncle Frank and I and a few others took Gran's ashes to the shrine, and we put them there. And then last year, I took Uncle John. Sorry about this. Anyway, so this year we were planning such a nice trip. Cole and myself and a few others, some of Gail's kids, and I think even one of Lynn's, I think, might have been coming, or Lynn was coming. And we were going to go and do a history tour of Rhodesia, or Bulawayo and the Falls and what have you. And of course, Uncle Frank was determined as ever, I'm driving up there. I mean, nobody's taking me up there and all this, and I'm in the car. And we're all trying to talk him out of it and say, no, you know, we need to plan this, and we do it differently. And not for one moment, even though I've known for some time that Uncle Frank was not well, not for one moment did I think that I would be strategizing with the family that I'm now taking Uncle Frank to the shrine. Anyway, I think it's been one heck of a life of Uncle Phil. It's been an amazing experience for me. A lot of life's lessons, men I've looked up to. Yeah, so, you know, Uncle Frank, I know you're watching over us. And I know when we get up to the shrine, when we get up to Bulawayo, and I'll take them and I'll show Cole and Auntie Dix. We'll find the farm, we know where they are, so we'll find them. We'll do our Bulawayo and history tour and take you to be with your brother and your mom and dad. To the rest of the family, yeah, you've been unbelievable over the last month. Unreal. I wish I could have been as strong as you were, especially Carl. Amazing. Because you had such a chat with your dad. Wow. And I know we were all there, but that was unbelievable, Carl. And guys, you know, I just think going forward, we look at it on the fun side and the good times of Uncle Frank and what we all had, and treasure those moments, because for me they were incredibly important. I'll never forget them. I'll never forget him. Yeah, and as the monks would say, I'm a gashli, boss. Take it easy. Until we meet again, thank you.
Frank's youngest child. If my dad was here today, he would be celebrating and paying respect to past and absent friends, something that he would do given any opportunity. And today, we're standing here and we're paying respect to him. And I'd like to give you a commitment that in future, I'm going to pay respect to past and absent friends and to him. At these times, we ask ourselves, what is the measure of someone's life? And in this past week, as I'm going through my mom and dad's house with my siblings, and his stuff in his garage that he loves so dearly, I ask myself, is this the sum of his life? And I quickly realize that his life is much more. His life is full and meaningful and impactful. And is greater than the possessions that he's left us. It became more apparent to me in the last 2 weeks, reading nearly 1,000 messages just before he passed away, and a week after he passed away. 1,000 people from all over the world sent him messages. Some he knew, some knew of him. But these messages were warm and kind and respectful towards him. Well, it also became apparent that when I was speaking to people here and on the phone elsewhere in the world, people, some of the people that I did not know, some of them I did, that how he touched their lives and how impactful he became in other people's lives. By the principles that he stood by, his fairness, don't steal, don't lie, be honest, be kind. By his absolute love and devotion towards his family, and his children, his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren. This picture yesterday, my friend Neil, reminded me of how important that picture is. This picture that you're looking at now is us in 2014 on the beach in Marco Island. And on the left is my dad, and the rest of the people is our family. And that was his family, that was him and my mom that created that, our patriarch. Every single one of his children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, and their spouses, is there. And Neil said to me, that is incredibly special. There's not many families that have that. It's not something that just happens. And we're grateful that we have that. Also by his unmistakable character. If you met Frank Stevens, you didn't forget Frank Stevens. The experiences and the contributions that he made wherever he went. He was truly a larger-than-life human being. I'll never forget the conversations and friendship we had. I'll never forget the stories he told about Rhodesia. Geez, we're not going to forget Rhodesia, that's for sure. About the farm, the dairy, him immigrating from Zimbabwe to South Africa and from South Africa to the United States. I'll never forget the fun and parties that we had, the river, and the times we spent in the army songs. We didn't like the army songs, but we did. I'll never forget the lessons that you taught me. And obviously I'll never forget the family reunions, for which there were plentiful. I'll miss our conversations and friendship. I'll miss our weekly calls, which he made to all of us. And I'll miss his company, being able to phone him and say, Dad, this is what I did today. This is the troubles I had, and how he supported me, relentlessly supported me. Whatever I did, he was so proud of me and all of us. I truly love you, and I will miss you. From Vicky and Alex, they truly love you, and they will miss you. From your children, Lynn, Gail, Mitch, Pauline, and myself, we truly love you, and we'll miss you. From your grandchildren and great-grandchildren, from your nieces and nephews, especially Rob, we truly love you, and we will miss you. From your sister, Auntie Marion, you truly loved your brother, and you will miss him. From all your friends around the world that you touched so beautifully, they will all miss you, and they truly loved you. And finally, and most importantly, to his darling, his dearless, his wonderful and devoted wife, Vicky, my mother, she truly loved you and will miss you with every part of her body. You have left an enormous gap, Pops, which will be very difficult to fill. We will love you and we'll never forget you. Rest in peace till we meet again.
I have done many memorial services, and usually you take people and say, we're time for tributes, and you expect 20 minutes. But we've learned a lot today. I just want to say something to you about one or two people before we just go on. I knew Rob a long time before I met him, because every time I spoke to Frank, he'd say, you know Rob, you know what he's doing? And then he'd say to me, but you know Russ, he was on last night. We'd be talking to each other of an evening. He'd say, listen, hold on, Bill, that's America. And so here is what it comes to, where people love. And we can wait for those people to express how they feel about that man. And so we're going to sing a hymn now. We're all going to stand, because that's the amazing grace. We're going to sing, and Frank was part of that amazing grace. He had something special that we can sing about.
Thank you.
I'm sorry about that. I thought you had the word to Okay, but what a wonderful thing, the amazing grace that lives in people. I know that you've heard everything, but I just need to leave you with a short message. You know, whilst giving thoughts of what a meaningful message should be, my mind went to how we should lead it. And I started off by looking back at Frank in Bulawayo and where he came from. And yes, he was tough. We didn't get in his way very much because he used to say, now look, I don't want to hit you, but if I do have to, you go to hospital. And so we kept out of his way. But I asked Dickie to tell me one or two things. I said, was he educated at Daisy Field? And that was a place where people that didn't have families went to. And she said, no, he went to Alan Wilson in Harare. And I remember that had a boarding house called St. Joseph's. And I know that was for underprivileged children, people that the parents just couldn't find the money for a more expensive place. But one of the things that was very good was his ability to develop his life. And he was a great sportsman, we saw him. Heard about that, and Dickie says, you know, he exceeded and excelled in rugby. Well, you know, when he left school, he had the urge to work for the earth, and he went to the farm for 3 years, Dickie told me, and he was mechanically minded. We've heard about that, and I know that in Bulawayo, I know that he ran a brake services place and he was excellent, but he tackled any vehicle and any earth-moving equipment. He was excellent, and he rented farms, but you know, in his secular work, the little money he earned, he had to buy a farm. He had to have his own farm. And then I know that he and Dickie always worked as a team during their stay on the farm. And a major part of that exercise was to have children and also to lead and direct their paths. And I know that times were tough. My own daughter went to stay on the farm for a weekend because she was friendly with Colleen. And also my son, Neville, had his eye on Colleen. But Frank stopped that one. Funnily enough, Colleen said to me when I walked in here today, Neville phoned me, and he's in Rustenburg. Don't know how he got the number, but he phoned it. But I do want to say that the farm was a place that. There was a mission. There was a mission. And you know, I wanted to read one or two things to you about that today, because the tough thing about all that Frank had to settle in South Africa and leave his beloved farm. The devoted children took leave of the family ties, and they chose to settle in the United States. They had received the foundation of life, and we've heard from the people that have spoken here today that Frank and Dickie had prepared them for the future. And today I want to take the life of Frank to one of the richest kings in the Bible, and that's King Solomon. And he lived several thousand years ago, but I want you to listen to this as I read the following passage. We need to listen carefully to this. There is an appointed time for everything, and there is a time for every event under heaven. There is a time to give birth and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot what is planted, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, and a time to mourn and a time to dance. There's a time to throw stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace and a time to shun embracing, a time to search and a time to give up as lost, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear apart and a time to sew together, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love, but there is also a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. And each one of these sayings was applicable to the man we are lifting up today. He really planted seeds. He joined his life to Dickie, and they planted the seeds of life into a unique family standing here today. Came a time for Frank to uproot what he had planted, to tear it down and begin a new life. Inside he must have wept. People may not have seen it, but I'm sure inside he must have wept as he entered South Africa. Following a time of rebuilding his and Dickie's life, he received the rewards of a family who loved their father. They gathered together and ensured that their father would have another chance in life. The United States of America was a huge continent, and they took him there for a period of 10 years. It was a continent of dreams, and he went over. His decision was to come and do his 10 years there and resettle in his beloved country of South Africa. And his decision was to come to Fisher Haven. And the wonderful thing about it, he had Don and his beloved sister Marion and Rob. And that family. He had done it all. He knew what it was like to sustain everything that was thrown his way. And his searching for peace had arrived. My introduction back to Frank was a phone call one day asking if we could renew our friendships. And I thought, I wonder what he's like. However, he was so keen, and we came together, and what an experience. We had the privilege of seeing all these qualities in this man that I'd never seen before. He could be using any one of Solomon's qualities, and I remember the times I used to chide him. I wanted to see how far I could test him, and I used to take him to the limits. And then he used to say to me, "Now listen to me, Bob. Be very careful. If I drop my voice and speak softly to you, then you can be sure that I'm going to deal with you in no uncertain manner." And we would have a great laugh about that, and we would embrace each other. I want to tell you, the day came that we stood at his gate with him and Dickie, and I took the liberty of trying to stretch my arms around that huge body. And I said to him, "Frank, I think I could love you as a brother." He said, no, don't start that now, eh? But let me tell you, eventually, we never parted without a bear hug. Never. Before Ez and I left. And once a week, our phone would go around about 8:30 at night. And I used to say, "Love, it's a very good program on TV because we've got one in the bedroom. But it's Frank." And I knew it would be 57 minutes because more time lasts an hour. And he would have it all there. And then one night I fell asleep. He says, "You fell asleep on me, you bugger." I said, "No, I'm here." But he didn't believe it, he knew. The years we had together were the best. We could enter into another world if we just meditate on the attributes of this man of distinction. He was kind and generous, I want to tell you about that. And he always went to the uttermost in making people happy. Let me tell you what we had. We had meals, we had braais, we had his own speciality of pickled fish. And we always had to taste. And the gifts out of his pocket-sized garden. Grapes, guavas, strawberries, pawpaws, beetroot and veggies of every kind. The phone calls to the bereaved who lost a soulmate and who originated from the beloved Rhodesia. And he used to phone me, do you know who's gone now, Bill? I thought, oh, who now? For everything there is a season, says Solomon. A time to be born and a time to die. In an instant, in one sentence, the author has expressed how fragile life is. And we know today that is definitely a time to be born and a time to die. It may be that the most important question we can answer is, what time is it for us? For each one of us here today, we know that we are creatures of time by the way we set our clocks and watches, so that we will know what hour it is. We have schedules and appointments set by dates on a calendar. That is why, measured by the relationships that we have with others, that is why you are here today. You don't have to measure time, but let us measure relationships. Because you knew Frank, you are a family of friends, and you have come to say goodbye. It is something that we have developed with somebody we loved. That is important, and I commend you for being here today. But let me ask, what time is it for you today again? Are any of us here today able to reflect on our own lives and say, we have no regrets, that we have done it all? Can we say we have lived the life that was given to us to the full, that we have sustained every change and every season? We've heard about the movement, we've heard about Rob, we've heard about all those times in Bulawayo, and we have had to sustain change. The writer of Ecclesiastes has said, there is a time and season for every event under heaven. There is a time to weep and a time to mourn, and I would say to you, for and the family, if there is ever a time that you need to mourn for this man, shed your tears freely, because they are the healing power that comes from above. When you grieve, a special healing takes place. It is also a time of remembering. Precious memories are sweet to the heart and mind. We've had so many today. We can thank God that we have the capacity to remember. Think of the good times that we have shared, the funny times when we have laughed. Yes, there were bad times, but in all our remembering, we will celebrate the wonderful life of Frank. It has been wonderful. Today is also a day of comfort, because Jesus said, I will never leave you, and I'm never going to forsake you. And that is so encouraging. He says, I've prepared a place for you, and I will take you with me. That is encouraging news. Frank declared that he had no religion, but today, should we not look back and through it all, will not say, well, I believe there was surely a higher power that cared for the life created in the body of Frank Elliot Stevens. And so I ask again, what time is it? Is it a time of grieving? It is also a time of remembering and also celebrating, and a time of comfort. And we placed our trust in the Lord above. And I repeat this in remembrance of Frank, because I had that put on the back of your service sheet, and that is Frank. It says, once do I go through life, any good deed that I can do, or any kindness that I can show unto my fellow men, let me do it now and not delay. It's not delay, as I will not pass this way again. And so, let me say that that time with Frank and the life he lived is a legacy for each one of us. And now, I just need to go back on my papers here. I'm getting mixed up here. Okay. I just want to end up with some prayers, and then we're going to do the final committal, and then we're going to have Mitch come along, and then we're going to have a final song, which when Mitch is finished, if you'll all just sit quietly, and we're going to end with one of Frank's favorite songs, I Did It My Way. But first of all, let us pray. Oh God, you are the King of life and glory. We thank you for the life of Frank, for all that is good and kind and loving. We thank you that for Frank, trials and temptations are over. Sickness and death is past. We thank you for a life well lived in you, a life that touched so many in a positive and loving way. It is a life for which we give you thanks. Frank Elliot Stevens is at rest. Can we all stand for the committal, please? Cherished memories that are forever sacred and comforted by the hope of life that shall endless be. We commit Frank Elliot Stevens into the earth, dust to dust and ashes to ashes, in the full assurance that he rests in peace. God bless you. And will you all please be seated? Mitch.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Mitch. I'm Frank's oldest son. And I'm going to do the final tribute. But before we get into that, I'd like to give thanks to a lot of people that made this event happen. The first group that I'd like to thank are my siblings. You guys have been great. Gail flew overseas, and Russell, as soon as Dad fell ill, they sat by his side for 4 weeks. Unbelievable. Thank you. The next person I'd like to thank is Bill. Bill, you've done a great job tonight. Thank you. Beryl and Lynn, thank you for the facilities. I appreciate it. It's wonderful to have the service in the neighborhood among these friends. I really appreciate that. Then we have a group of friends that helped make this function possible. Neil and Adele, Rev, thank you. Gina, Joe, thank you for all your contributions. Bob and Jill, thanks for helping out throughout this whole 4 weeks. You guys have been great. And to everybody that's traveled here to respect my dad, thanks for coming out. We appreciate it. When I think of my dad, I often think of the word associations. And we've heard this already throughout the tributes today. And I'd like you all to just think about that for a second. What words come to mind when you think about my dad? The words I came up with were family, loyalty, compassion, honesty, hardworking, principles, and above all else, pretty funny, good sense of humor. So, some of this Russell has already covered in Gail, but I would like to just spend a few minutes talking about the relationship I had with my dad. You know, like my siblings, we grew up on a farm. But as the boy, I had a different role to the girls. And my job was to to be at my dad's side the whole time. And so we did everything together. You know, we plowed and fixed engines and built stuff. And then in the summers I worked, holidays I worked in the garage. Many hours holding the flashlight frame, go get the half inch tool. No, not half inch Whitworth, half inch SE, you know. For the mechanical guys, you know what that means. But there's a lot of life lessons that he passed on. And I think he missed me when I first went down to Jericho. Dale and I lived together and came down. We spent a few years in South Africa, and then I decided to go to America. And the interesting part is he was really opposed to that, which is kind of hard to think about it now, but he was quite angry that I was leaving South Africa to go to America. Once we got established and sponsored mom and dad, he changed his mind. He actually thought America was pretty cool. And it really was one of the best things that they did. And we missed them like crazy when they came back to Fishhaven. It was our loss and your gain. But in many respects, that was, gave my mom and dad a chance to have a really relaxed and familiar environment to have their retirement. And we're very grateful for everybody around her who got to know them. So, you know, my dad taught me a lot of practical skills, as I mentioned, you know, improvisation. He was the epitome of the farmer makes a plan. Or the Shane Alcons, I guess, the farmer by the plan or something. Is that close? But besides the skills, there's all these kind of character lessons, how to be honest with people. I'll bet my dad could have made a lot more money in the garage. But there were many times that he took a bit of compassion, did something for free. And I don't remember customers that weren't happy in that place. Those are powerful life lessons. For 30 plus years, our family's made weekly phone calls, as we've heard already. Hour-long phone calls, catching up on all the news. He showed a great interest in all of our lives. What have you done? How's this going? And that's something we're going to miss. It's a big part of our weekend routine was calling mom and dad. So we're going to miss that a lot. Now, losing your dad is not easy. It's one of the toughest things that we have to go through. But I think it's also an opportunity to take a step back and look at things that you should be grateful for, that we're grateful for. And I'll just go down a few of them. We're grateful for that. That's really important to all of us. Family. We're grateful for the fact that my dad had a dignified passing. He was able to spend time with all of us at his bedside. We're grateful that he didn't come out of hospital a completely compromised person. In many ways, this was a blessing. He was 85 years old. We had him for 85 years. And I think it's worthwhile remembering that this could have gone much worse than it did. So we're grateful for that. The other thing, this is an end of a chapter for our family. We're looking with some degree of hope moving forward. Mom's coming over to America to stay with us. What we're not going to forget is Dad, he's going to be with us the whole time. And, you know, we're a close to family, we expect to stay close, and we know that he'll be proud of us as we take Mom and give her another whole chapter in life, which we're looking forward to. All right. On a more sort of lighthearted thing, this is a celebration of life. And the old man always said, I want everybody to have a pizza party at my funeral. You probably heard it, and you're probably telling me that. We have countless beers and wine and alcohol out there. We have a nice meal that we've made. And I'd like everybody to really enjoy themselves tonight, to think about what he would want to do. Don't be mournful. This is a celebration of life. He had a great life. And we're all going to move forward remembering a great life. Okay? And as Bill mentioned, we're going to listen to what I think is the most appropriate song for Dad. Mm-hmm.
so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway. More, much more than this, I did it.
Can we just close this service? Just pray. The peace of God, which passes all human understanding, be with each one of you and bless you. And as you go on your way, let the grace of God be over you, protect you, and shadow your life, and let all things come together for good. In His holy name we pray.
Amen.
How are you?
So,
that's good.